an extension of the open system, and we all know the that there's thoracolumbar spine. That is the basic the basic segment of the whole spine where we're going to do this kind of a fixation. And so what are the parts of any vertebra? So we have the sawbone model. Later on you can have a look, and I think all of us are exposed to sawbone model, but we don't look at it with that kind of minute detail that we are required to. And I think it this workshop gives us all an opportunity that we go through it and look at the shape of the body, the vertebral foramen, the pedicle, because the orientation and perspective changes with the side from which you are looking at. So if you look at this thoracic vertebra out here, you can see that the superior articular facet, the angulation of the superior articular facet, and the inferior articular facet out here. So this is the, and how the transverse foramen, the transverse facet looks at transverse the tubercle out here. Everything is different from a different angulation. And this orientation you have to understand, because in a patient you will not get access to this orientation. You have to imagine all this by looking at the sawbone models and constantly thinking how it will be looking. Then only you will get the anatomy correctly while you're doing a percutaneous procedure or an open procedure. And the most important things for any screw fixation is, one is the transverse process, the other is the lamina, and then we have the superior articular facet. So these three basically form the, I would say, anatomical landmarks for putting in a screw in an open procedure. Now before we put in, we have to also understand the pedicle anatomy. So the pedicles are of different shapes and sizes, and various classifications are there in the literature. I'll not dwell into it, but sometimes may be very difficult to put in a screw because the pedicle may be very thin or sclerotic or have some other pathology which may make screw insertion difficult, irrespective of whether you're doing it percutaneously or through open means. And in these kind of pedicles, then other means are described where you go even more laterally through the transverse process or out in technique, and which I will just talk about briefly later on. So what are the indications? Any of these indications also become indications for percutaneous fixation. Okay, so there is no major contraindication of percutaneous fixation. You can do for any kind of stabilization, including degenerative spondylolisthesis, for tumors, for infection, and as Dr. Vijay showed, it could be pod spine, it could be spondylolisthesis, it could be a trauma, it could be deformity. All these can be done with percutaneous fixation. Significant osteoporosis, obviously a contraindication for both, for open as well as with the cannulated screws, with cement and all this, you can try, but it is a relative contraindication. Now the trajectory, again, this is something which is very, very important, because you do not want, one is obviously post-op your x-ray should look nice, but that is a very secondary thing. More importantly, your trajectory should be in the right alignment, so that maximum load sharing can occur in the bodies, and that is the main thing. And thoracic spine, obviously you can see this is from the AO book. You have to have the main landmark, which is the lateral border of the superior facet, the lateral border of the inferior facet, and the ridge of the pars interarticularis and the transverse process. So when you have these landmarks which show on the sawbone model, you will get this. And if you draw a line, I'm getting this line, and you draw a line which is lateral to the superior articular facet, which is going through the transverse process and going through the midpoint of the inferior articularis, this is the point in the thoracic spine you should be putting in your screw. So angulation, again, in this, it has to go as close to in the mid body as possible. And in the lumbar spine, again, you have these landmarks of pars interarticularis. The additional important landmark we get in the lumbar spine is that of the mammillary process. So mammillary process, which comes out here from the superior articular facet out here, that becomes a very important point, because you can ronger that mammillary process and directly go into it. So for open techniques, but these will remain still, as I said, when we put in the wire, the K wire, after that you can still orient yourself and put your screws easily, even if they are non-cannulated. And trajectory, obviously, it increases from L1 to L5. So you can see at L3 it is around 15 degrees, at L5 it will become 25 degrees. So remember the trajectories, remember how medial you have to be. If you have this information in your mind, it helps you better with planning your pedicle screw placements. So I'll now come to our important thing, that is missed spine and percutaneous screw placement. So first, it's been there for a very, very long time, 1977. And as Dr. Vijay already pointed out, Foley's was one of the pioneers in this field. With fluoroscopic navigation, CT navigation, robotics, it has become almost like a video game, putting in percutaneous screws. However, for the vast majority, we'll have to use it under fluoroscopy guidance. And that remains the mainstay, and that is why you should know how to do it with the minimum exposure. So you can get burnt just continuously having that X-ray on. That should not happen. You should be using it as less as possible, the X-ray. Two things which are very important to understand in percutaneous screw fixation is, one is only instrumentation and one is instrumented fusion. So when we talk about instrumentation, this is usually done in, I would say, fractures or grade 1 listhesis or a lot of other cases where you just want temporary stability of the spine, natural healing to occur, so that you can take out the screws at a later date. So most of the fractures where we are doing in percutaneous fixation, you can actually take out the screws after a variable time period, let's say around 7 months to 1 year. So that the person, and these are all young people whom we are doing it, so they actually have a reconstituted spine with no fixation. And that is the ideal for most of these patients. Whereas instrumented fusion is what we are talking about, is that we put in a screws along with some kind of fusion, which could be a posterior lateral fusion using bone grafts or using some other kind of method like T-lift, O-lift, D-lift, anything you can think of, A-lift, having a fusion in place so that that segment becomes immobile. So I hope you understand this difference. Now, as we talked, and Dr. Vijay has also shown, the open and the percutaneous procedure, the main difference is between muscle splitting and muscle erasure. So here we are splitting it, and the view in the open, obviously, because of the huge amount of muscles stripping and everything going on, the everything increases the pain as well as the blood loss, other complications related to the stripping. Whereas in the percutaneous, we have a splitting incision, so we are just going in directly and avoiding all the drawbacks of the stripping part. So the steps are, which we saw previously also, if you have some kind of guidance or navigation, it's very good. Other than that, you have to do it in the which view. If you have a fluoroscope, AP or lateral, which view would you use? Lateral. AP. So if you want only one view, AP is the best. Always do your percutaneous procedure under AP. Why we want to do it under AP, anterior posterior view? To see the pedicles. So your pedicles have to be visible as oval things, and this is what you're supposed to see. So these are the pedicles. Can you see all that? This is the pedicle, and this has to be in the middle of the spinous process. You have to make sure it is a true AP. Now there are various techniques. People have done a lot of work on this, and I'll just briefly allude to what other people are doing, but the standard technique of percutaneous screw fixation is you have a true AP. Now what happens in the normal when your patient is lying prone, you have some lordosis. So if you keep your X-ray machine absolutely straight, you will not get a true AP. You have to angle it in line so that it is actually oblique to the floor, but anterior posterior to the body. I hope I am clear about it. So it is angulated around 20 to 30 degrees in the anterior posterior direction, so that it is parallel and exactly perpendicular to the lumbar spine. So this is then only you will get this. Secondly, there are two parts of the X-ray machine, the generator, the X-ray generator, and the head. So your head of that should be closer to the patients to get a clearer image. And obviously you have to adjust the exposure and everything. Otherwise you will not see these pedicles and you'll be struggling. If you are struggling, obviously you will spend too much time pressing the button, creating problems, exposing yourself to unnecessary radiation, and maybe not getting a proper trajectory. Also, the second thing is you have to see the medial part. The medial part of the pedicle is more important because this is where your, I would say, breach can lead to problems. Now, I want to show you this. This is a cannulated, can you see that? This is the cannulated instrument which we are putting over the wire. Why I'm showing you this, I'll come to it in the next slide. This is a technique which was developed by some authors. Now what it requires is a special instrument. Okay, what is there in this instrument? The instrument in the distal portion, it is defined. This is an instrument, let's say, in 40 millimeters or 4 centimeters of this instrument is thinner than the proximal part. So you have to have a differentiator. It could be 40 millimeters, it could be 30 millimeters. So if you have this, if you have a corrugated or serrated margin and you measure it, it becomes the same thing. So any instrument which goes over the wire, you can make it out to be similar like this. Now what the authors say is, you see the width of the pedicle. Okay, you see the width of the pedicle. This is just a CT to give you a reference. What is the width of the pedicle? If your, this is a 40 millimeter thing. If on a AP X-ray, when you have put in your this instrument inside, if you see that the width of the pedicle is, I would say, less. The width of the instrument is less than the width of the pedicle, that means it is going laterally. They are all at the lateral margin. We are supposed to go at which point in the pedicle are we supposed to introduce? 2 o'clock, very good, 2 o'clock. Superior, laterally, going into the pedicle. So if it's the first X-ray we see, it looks relatively normal, okay? But this is actually going laterally. Why? Because this whole distance from here to here is visible less than the width of the pedicle. If you see the last images, if we are going, see the width of this instrument, how much we are seeing the last 40 millimeters. It is bigger than the width of the pedicle. So that means we are going too medially. Can you make that out, the angulation here? So okay, I'll explain it again. I'm just telling you there are different ways people have devised. This is the instrument, let's say. Okay, so you can use the tap, you can measure the, because the tap has a around 40 millimeters of distance of the tap, which cannulated tap which goes over the guide wire. So use that instead of this instrument, which is there available with every set. In this instrument, the last 40 millimeters is thinned out. Okay? So what the authors are doing here is, when you take your first shot, you just look at how much of the last, this 40 millimeters is visible on the X-ray. Is it less, more, or normal as compared to the standard width of a pedicle? Very simple. So just by your first shot, you can make an approximate idea whether you're going in the right direction or too medially or too laterally. Am I clear here? Yes, the center, these two are fine. B and C, B is giving you the orientation. E is fine, F is too medial, D is too lateral. Alright? So, this gives you the orientation. The second is, the outline of the steps is, if you're doing navigation, obviously you need to put in a reference frame first. If you're not using navigation, we just have your X-ray machine, as I talked about, the fluoroscope or the image intensifier. Mark your levels and use your Jamshedi needle to and tap it, making sure that it is where it should be, that is at the superior lateral part of the pedicle. Now some authors also have tried another way of inserting the pedicle screw is, after doing the true AP, okay, they rotate the X-ray machine 15 to 20 degrees on the side of the, because if you see the direction of the pedicle here, this is like this, angled around 25 to 30 degrees. So if you make your X-ray machine come in that direction, it will appear a owl's eye appearance. That is what they call as the owl's eye appearance in the, for the percutaneous pedicle screw insertion technique. And in that, after doing the true AP, you tilt it 20 or 30 degrees laterally, and then you put your screw directly in line with the X-ray machine. Is it understood? So these are various techniques you should be knowing. You obviously you'll be doing the very basic what we are doing every day in and day out. But later on, you should be knowing what are the other options available, how people have tried to reduce the fluoroscopy time and the X-ray time. So if you have it in line, then they directly put in without getting multiple shots. So it goes in with this direction, and then they again change the direction of the machine on the opposite side, another 20 degree on the left or the right, and put it. So after you have put in your guide wire, you put in your the K wire, you put in your Jamshedi needle over it. If you have image guidance, well and good. Otherwise, then you start the tap. And if you're using Jamshedi, obviously you'll be putting Jamshedi first and then the K wire. Remove the Jamshedi and put the tap over it. So this we'll be showing you today. This is all relatively simple. It is a step-by-step process, how you dilate what you have inserted, and after the dilatation, put on your screwdriver with the screw loaded on it and insert the screw. So this is what the screw is being put, which has been loaded onto the screwdriver and the extender. And this is what we get. So we have the screws inserted with the extenders coming out, and this is where the problem lies. So this is exactly what Dr. Vijay was saying, that distraction is not really, it sounds very easy, but when you're doing distraction on a percutaneous system, it is not that simple. See, this is, if you do this, it is supposed to distract. You're putting one screw like this and another screw like this, the extenders. You will assume that they are there, but there is minimum distraction. Nothing happens. You understand what I'm saying? So, and you're supposed to lock these two. You cannot over distract anyway. How will you lock it? It's a problem in these systems. So you are supposed to lock it. So they have been angled like this and locked into position. And this is what is, and you cannot have a person holding it also in the opposite direction. So these are all practical limitations of the system in terms of distraction. They have been designed with a specific distraction in mind. And then you have this kind of a sharp attachment to it, which goes into the skin. This is shaped exactly in the shape of the rod which will be going in. So this creates a tunnel, subcutaneous tunnel, goes into and fits inside the screw head. And this is the cartoon which shows how this is getting created. And when we load it with the rod, which is a pre-measured depending on the distance between the two screws, which we see on the X-ray, the rod will go in and will get. So at this point, it is very important that you get a lateral view also. Why a lateral view here? The reason is the rod may be coming out, may have not gone into one of the heads, or it may be lying loose. So you need both the views to make sure that it is correctly lined in the AP as well as the lateral view. So this is what we talked about, the distractive maneuver, which really never works properly. And then you fix the rods with these screws, and that is the standard method, and that in itself is the percutaneous pedicle screw fixation. So this is one of those cases where we had a fracture, and but there was no significant compression. Small amount of distraction obviously occurs in the percutaneous system. So you can see that this fracture has been stabilized, and this is what is instrumentation. There is no fusion in these cases. So after a certain time, ideally you should be removing this whole system. Otherwise the hardware will break, because most of these patients are young 20-30 year old people who have been involved in some kind of injury. And if you do not remove it, you will have breakage of the hardware, because we are not aiming to do any fusion in these patients. So technical nuances I've already talked about. This is how the cannulated screw appears on the X-ray, and this is what your incisions is. So you can make out that the incision is very small. In fact, if you're doing in the guide wire placement, you just have to join these two incisions, as Dr. Vijay was saying, and you have it ready for mini TLIF on either side when you want. So sclerotic pedicle, as I said, if you have pedicles with a thin or sclerotic, you might want to take this screw from outside in, bypassing this pedicle or going through this pedicle, so to ensure that there is no medial breach in the canal. You understand? And complications, obviously, complications are not uncommon, and we have a grading for complications. Usually, because of a breach, if there is no neural impingement, patient is fine. They may not be need to revise or remove the screw. When is it required to remove the screw? You've done a percutaneous placement. What your X-ray shows or your CT shows that there is a medial breach. Okay. Would you go in and remove the screw? Or what factor will make? Suppose it's grade 3, grade 2, or grade 3. What is the difference between these two? There is a neurological sequelae. So what is the neurological? If the patient is complaining of severe burning pain, if there's something happening and you see a medial breach, it is an indication to go in and take out the screw. You understand? But if the patient is completely asymptomatic, you can decide whether you really want to take it out, or you, because it's another surgery. So if a patient is symptomatic, definitely we have operated on a lot of patients who had instrumentation done complaining of severe pain. You know, you remove the screws and the pain will disappear most. So there are a lot of reasons for having this pain, and I think the benefit of doubt should be given to the instrumentation. Yes.
You know, because you know, routinely we kind of check with the neuro monitor, and you can avoid this patient waking up, because then, as you say,
yes,
it is another surgery. Then you're dealing with the expense, the angst, the anger, the whole lot. So you know, sometimes the neural, particularly breaches, will actually show up when you sort of do neuromonitoring and check the pedicles out. So if you have the technology available, it's a useful adjunct. And
yeah, Yeah. And is the kind of standard of the practice abroad, means like many people for each and everything, they check the pedicle breach and then they readjust. Many of the time they, means like whenever something on neuromonitoring, it seems like there is a breach. When they remove it and check out, there is nothing, but at least they are absolutely sure that nothing is wrong at that particular moment and there's a peace of mind.
So I totally agree with Dr. Vijay, and if you have neuromonitoring available, I think we should all be using it. In fact, Medtronic has a system where they attach it to the pedicle screw or to one of those extender or whatever. So when you are going in, it will give you an alarm if it is too close to the nerve. So it is meant for, because neuromonitoring per se requires a huge setup. You require a physiologist other expensive machines. Here also the machine is expensive, but you don't require anybody else. You just attach it and you will get to know. But it depends on availability. So these are the various kinds of breaches we are seeing. And you should not think that percutaneous screw is a simple technique. You have to understand that. It has its own set of complications. It can be very difficult. And it based on the bone morphology and the quality of the bone, it can be a really painful task for surgeons to sometimes put in the screws. So, as I said, remember cortical violations do not mean that there's going to be a neurological deficit, and you have to be careful. Obviously, if you have neuromonitoring, that's the best. And always use proper entry points, make sure trajectory is correct to avoid all these kind of things. So hardware problems, there are a lot of hardware problems without fusion. Obviously, as I said, if you keep your hardware in for too long, it will cause a lot of issues such as breakage, removal, and pseudoarthrosis, and screw fractures. We have seen all of these in our institution, and these are the major complications, which we have also seen. And so, although very rare, most of them, you should have them in your mind that yes, these things can occur. So pedicle screw fixation is one of the best techniques actually in instrumentation which we have in armamentarium, and we should have a thorough knowledge of the surgical anatomy. There can be no second option for this. Without your anatomy, even if you have image guidance, even you have a mobile CT, it will not make a difference, because all these technical equipments have their own margins of error, and if they fail, you will be stuck. So you should always have a backup plan. If everything fails, yes, how can you still open up the patient and do in a proper normal screw fixation? So thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes, Dutta, here's a question.
Sir, it is seen that sometimes the lumbar pedicles, sometimes it is seen that it is a very thin pedicle in some patients. And since it's a three-column fixation, so would you recommend for the lumbar pedicles, can we use that in-out-in technique that we use sometimes in dorsal? It's a very thin pedicle,
yes,
we go laterally and...
That's exactly what I said. If you have a thin pedicle, you have a sclerosed pedicle. Sometimes you keep hammering, it will not go in.
Yeah.
It's very, very sclerosed.
Sometimes it may break.
Yes, sometimes break. So you can have various techniques. You can go laterally, you can go extra laterally. You know, there's so many techniques to that. And one point which this brings out is you should study your CT images very well before you go in. We tend to just gloss over them. Okay, it's been done, MRI, VC, and just go and put in a... You should always get a CT scan.
CT scan done.
And you should evaluate your CT scan to see for sclerosis, to see for the pedicle width, and to see for the orientation. So if you know all that beforehand, it will make things easier.
Thank you, sir. Yeah.
Anybody has any question?
So I think we'll have some sawbone models also.
Yes, sir.
So
yes.
You can practice the...
Yeah, at least there will be models, and at least they can understand the anatomy and what
yes,
things
absolutely.
Happen. Yeah. So thank you very much, sir. I think it's very good description of anatomy. And